Good day, everybody, and welcome to yet another episode of Unleash with FTEM, Unleash with From the Expert's Mouth. And today we have a very interesting episode lined up for you with multiple threads in this promising conversation with Siddharth Das.
I started my career back in 2001 in the FMCG space, worked for a very short while with Johnson & Johnson. For the last 15 years, I had been associated with customer engagement and customer loyalty sort of platforms built for B2B and retail organizations mostly. And focusing around customer experience, how to measure and even better customer experience.
And so, you know, coming to the problem that you were trying to solve, you mentioned that you had a lot of experience in solving customer experience and customer service sort of issues. So did that lead to the forming of Big Grocer, and how do the two dovetail to create an enterprise or a solution?
Okay. So, it dates back to my engagement with Oracle as a product manager starting 2006, where I was the product manager with Oracle for their CRM suite of applications, how to manage customers, right, overall. And eventually, I joined Capillary Technologies as a director of product for campaigns, loyalty, survey, and feedback. And I was the head of product for a customer experience company, which actually, again, into customer feedback and, action management, which is called Litmus World, right? So everywhere, if you see the trend, it's all about customer experiences, customer management, loyalty management, how to engage and re-engage customers. Until with CleverTap, it was all about re-engagement of customers on a mobile app. So almost all the large, brands in India are actually customers of or clients of CleverTaps. And we used to send push notifications and in-app notifications and analyze customer journeys and try to make their journeys better over the app or over as associated with a particular brand. So that's where it all started. And we figured out that these are typically the larger companies who are using it. Can we build something for the smaller businesses, which help them increase their customer loyalty and increase customer engagement in an automated, in a centrally operated manner, so that they'll have to put in the least amount of effort? That's where it started, because it's the same learning for 15 years, as I said, which has now come into a very different industry altogether. That's the difference.
Right. Right. Yeah. So firstly, I think, from the audience perspective, the leaky bucket problem is a, great analogy to give to what is happening, not just in the online grocery or the quick commerce sort of space, but in a lot of other, segments of the startup ecosystem.
So I'll give you a good an example that we learned, firsthand. In fact, two examples. The first one is about personal relationship. When we had that one single delivery rep, moment we changed the delivery rep, a lot of customers actually complained. Some even stopped ordering, saying that your initial delivery rep was a very nice person. He was so receptive to the comments and the suggestions we gave. He was so nice while interacting with us. He took care of us. But the new delivery reps, they're pretty robotic in nature, because we hired them from some competition, food delivery business competition, who were, trained in such a way that, you just go and deliver the pack, don't open it or whatever, right? And that's where we figured out the, deep connect happening between a customer and a delivery rep. That is number one. The second part of the leaky bucket was around pricing. So that was the month of December, and oranges were a favorite, oranges were, and it was selling at around 50 rupees in the local language we call Hali. Hali is basically four oranges, okay? A pack of four oranges was selling at around 50 to 60 rupees. And our market, because we don't stock anything, we get it from vendors and wholesalers and distributors in that particular city. Our market intelligence told us that we were getting a higher rate. I mean, they were giving it to us as a higher rate. So when we confronted them, they said these same four pieces of oranges are even available at 25 rupees, whatever they were giving us at 60 rupees, but the quality varies. So we said, why don't we list the poor quality items, mention that it's an ordinary quality and the other one is superior quality, and list it at a lower price. So what happened was, we give a discount on top of it, because whatever margin we get from the distributor or the wholesaler, automatically we decide what will be the you know, the commission for the delivery reps, what is going to be the customer's discount, and what is going to be our profit margin from there. So these items, this poor quality oranges, were offered at a price which was lower than the market. Mm-hmm. And a lot of customers started ordering them because they figured out that oranges are available, you know, 4 pieces at 20 rupees. But these were smaller. These were not of proper quality. Now, even though we mentioned it that it is a regular quality or small quality, and then there was a superior one, people went in for the smaller one because they saw a very dirt cheap price. But once they got it in their hands, they were deeply dissatisfied. And that's where we earned, learned our second lesson. And that happens in mostly in marketplaces where there are multiple sellers, and if each one of them would list more or less the same set of items, but with different varying levels of quality. And the one with the poorest quality will have the least price. And customers will check the, you know, compare the prices, go in for the one with the lowest, poorest quality, but expect the highest quality when they receive it. Right. So that's another reason, you know, there are multiple reasons like this, which leads to the dissatisfaction. So eventually what we decided is we started whenever, because it is like a small area, every franchise that we have operates within half a kilometer radius. They almost know every customer by face, or at least get to interact with them. So whenever they see a new customer, they immediately call up the customer and actually set some expectation in terms of payments, in terms of quality of items, in the fact that we actually return the items if it is found to be of poor quality. And you know, we have a reverse logistics which is much easier now because of this. So expectation setting is done by the front, you know, the people in the you know, facing the customer. And that is what actually makes a lot of difference in terms of managing the customer, in terms of addressing or attacking the leaky bucket problem. Right. So we need to make sure that the, you know, information actually comes, flows back to us so that we can improve upon our strategy. Now, if we, you know, unfortunately or fortunately, we could not raise enough funding in the previous rounds. So we did not spend too much on just pushing, you know, spending marketing dollars. We were very careful and cautious just to run that pilot within one single pin code, not having too many partners and not having too many customers, and just observing and learning from the experience that we have while transacting with those customers.
Right. No, that's very interesting. And apart from the, you know, leaky bucket problem, which relates to the marketing and the value proposition for the customers, I think the core of the experience is the interface and, you know, the person who's representing the organization. You interestingly mentioned that the people who came in from that competition were more robotic. And that is what at least we see in our experiences, because probably their KPIs and their incentive mechanisms are tied to the speed of their delivery and the response times that they have, rather than the customer experience, because obviously that becomes more intangible and more difficult to measure as compared to the delivery times, which are, you know, available straight off the bat in the app. And since that is being optimized, I think what it does is it creates a breed of workforce which has a completely different mindset, which is an antithesis to customer experience.
And, perfect. I think that's absolutely what it is. In fact, while we hire, we actually look for a very different set of people, because we call them as customer development officers. Okay, they are actually micro entrepreneurs. They are representatives of the company or the brand. And their fate is complete, or our fate is completely related to their own fate and how they perform on the field. So there's a lot of training in required. We need to pick and choose those, you know, those sets of customer development officers going through some kind of a process, through a filtration process.
Right. And you mentioned you're doing this in, you know, the tier 3-4 cities. So which parts of the country are you present in, and what is your expansion plan in terms of the geography?
So we are currently operating out of just one city in the northeast, which is Agartala. Over the next 6 months, we plan to expand to two other cities. One is Guwahati and the other one is Imphal. And over the next 1 year, we plan to be live across five different cities, you know, five additional different cities in different regions of the country, so that we can set up a regional team And over the next 4 to 5 years, we can expand within those regions to 20 to 25 cities in under each of these regional heads. That's what the plan is like.
Right. That's awesome. And, you know, you mentioned the first phase cities are all in the Northeast. And, you know, a lot of people, particularly those, you know, born and brought up and having stayed their lives in the metro cities, do not have as much of an understanding or appreciation of the Northeastern region. At least until a few years ago. Now things have been changing at quite a rapid pace. But, you know, from a business perspective, help us understand, you know, how is the Northeast as a region? And what is your advice or, you know, your thoughts on doing business in the Northeast for people who do not belong to the Northeast?
Okay. See, ours is a very standardized business, even though there are variations and exceptions galore. We are dealing with groceries. We are dealing with items of daily need. There is hardly any families in India who don't consume groceries or don't, you know, transact for items of daily need. So our target is a city with a population between 5 lakhs to 40 lakhs. Okay, between 5 to 20 lakhs is what is a tier 3 city, and 20 to 40 lakhs is a tier 2 city for us. Okay, and then we have made smaller segments within those cities. So Agartala is a tier 3 city, one of the smallest city with, 6 lakh population. And like they say in product management, always start with the easiest problem first, the smallest city first, so that you can scale. So for us, Imphal is also more than 5 lakhs and Guwahati is around 12 lakhs. That's the reason why we have chosen those three cities. And it will exhaust our first phase one of market launches in the entire Northeast, because these are the three cities that qualify according to our definition. We are constrained by the availability of distributors and wholesalers. Also because we do it everything in real time, unlike any of our competition who actually does the stocking of those items. It not only helps us reduce the inventory cost or cost of warehousing operations, it helps us actually present a much, much larger catalog of items to the end consumer. We are at least 2 to 3 times larger than our nearest competition in terms of the range of items that we can offer. Because all that we have to show is the data from a distributor instead of stocking those items, which might include a lot many items that are very slow moving. If we would have acquired them, probably it would have expired on the shelf and it would have been good for any of us. So doing business in the Northeast is not very different, unlike what we think, but it also depends upon the nature or the category of business that you are doing. Grocery business is more or less the same in terms of demand and people's consumption patterns, but decision making is very different. Where you have people are more receptive to pricing, and it's again a kind of a fad, or you can say it's a misnomer when you say that they are very receptive to pricing. If you look at a regular customer and then see where they typically source their item from, that is probably not the best or the most inexpensive source that they get from. They use the yardstick of pricing to initially decide upon a particular source of transaction. But eventually, once they've settled, they actually transact with a source that is convenient for them or where they have the maximum amount of confidence. Okay. And that's what we have figured out even in the Northeast, where we thought that levels of income are lower and people will be more receptive to pricing. But yes, their initial attraction, the way to attract customer, acquisition of customer is through pricing. But eventually when they settle down, it is with some other parameters, not just pricing. Okay. Other parameters are of, you know, much more importance than pricing, actually, I would say.
Right.
And transacting in tier one cities probably is slightly different. Okay, just because the lifestyle of people are different, they have lesser time. In fact, there is a thumb rule that we use saying that the amount that you spend on groceries, if it is double digit percentage of your income, then you fall into a very different category, right? Which means if you spend more than 10% of your income on groceries, then you think differently. Right. Right. It's not 10%, it's basically what it means, a significant portion of your earnings versus an insignificant portion of your earnings. Right. That's how this thing matters, actually. Right. So that's the difference, I would say. And it's more evident between a tier 2-3 city or a tier one city versus Northeast and the rest of the country.
Correct, correct. Yeah. And by and large, I would imagine, you know, any tier three city, whether it's in Northeast or any other part of the country, would have less of competitive intensity because, you know, at least from the perspective of the kind of organizations that are brewing in the startup ecosystem and those which are relying on, you know, online or app-based e-commerce, they are mostly targeting tier one and tier two, but not so much tier three and beyond. So I think that also plays out to your advantage if you've got your business model in place.
Sure. So, I mean, just to support your point, if you look at the biggest name in grocery tech, right? I think in the first 10 years, they were available in 25 cities. The second largest name was, you know, was there in probably 20 cities. The expandability is a big problem there. And we believe that none of the existing models can, you know, successfully expand into smaller cities. Okay. Mm-hmm. The primary reason being, if you have a warehousing model and the number of warehouses you have actually increases your operating cost, even though your delivery cost might go down, but your operating cost of warehouse, the damages that happen, the rotting that happens, and the staff that you need of different skills that you need to, you know, staff each of these warehouses is also going to rise exponentially. Plus, if you go into a smaller city, the density of population is lower. So your delivery staff is going to be less and less efficient out there, right? The, you know, per capita distance that you have to travel with the existing models is going to be higher in tier two cities, which means your profitability will further go down, right? So with any of the existing models or the renowned existing models that you see in operation in tier one cities today, it is almost going to be not possible to venture into the smaller cities as it stands today.
Right. Yeah. And I'm sure, you know, for a 1,000-pound gorilla to change their business model and create a differentiated business model for two different parts of the country is obviously going to be much more difficult than for, you know, a nimble new startup, which is kind of creating their own template from scratch, like you guys are doing. So, you know, certainly I would say the odds are stacked in, you know, favor of David and Goliath team, favor of the smaller one.
So what I figured out in my, you know, regular product management career is, and in that one point in time with one of the organizations, we said we will even, you know, open source our code. So it is not just building the code or copying the code, which actually is replicating. You have to go through that experiences and need to have extreme amount of conviction in the approach that you are taking. And every organization or their management needs that kind of an experience or that conviction in the approach. Right. And that doesn't come immediately when you are already, you know, tied up with a lot of other things. You should be able to run experiments faster. You should be able to think outside the box. Whenever you are running an experiment, you need to know where you are going and, you know, make sure that you are looking clearly at product market fit rather than thinking of how to spend the marketing dollars, which is actually lying with you.
Right. Okay.
And, so this is basically that's where we built it up from scratch. It's a pure, you know, innovation, and it's basically market-led innovation that has brought us into this. And we believe that going forward in those cities, no one will ever go and start a grocery store on their own, where they'll have to spend maybe 5 to 10 lakhs in terms of investment, or, you know, they will have to put in some staff, some place to actually do the business. Right. And have maybe a 20% chance of success. Whereas with us, there is absolutely zero investment, hire the number of customers because their backend is completely managed by us. Okay. In fact, we also manage the end customer experience, but it is done in collaboration with the local entrepreneur. Okay. And their chances of success with zero investment is much higher than that of, you know, if they would have invested in their own businesses. So that's where I think the primary, you know, difference is coming in. Instead of creating a brand or through spending a lot of money on marketing, we are actually building a human network into every household, which is pretty strong, which is tried, tested, and iterated upon. And that will last over a longer period of time than any kind of, you know, advertisement or promotion-led branding that you do. That's what we believe in.
Right. And of course, you have the technology backbone to, you know, support and scale the human network, right? Yeah. No, and interestingly, you mentioned, you know, the element of innovation, and the startup ecosystem was supposed to be synonymous with innovation, because, you know, tech-based innovation was really the foundational plank, or is supposed to be the foundational plank of the startup ecosystem. But at least from my vantage point, what I have observed is a lot of people just follow the crowd and ape what is being done, you know, and what is being seen everywhere, whether it is in terms of, you know, how to raise funds, when to raise funds, how to utilize funds, or whether it is in terms of business model. So a similar business model, and you will find, you know, 3-4 copycat business models with slight change in, you know, target segment or whatever. But by and large, it's the same template kind of copy-pasted without applying much thought. So, you know, you've spoken about innovation, and you yourself have pivoted, which obviously means that you've thought through deeply 5 different business models in, you know, this short span of time. So what are your thoughts on how to be innovative and how to kind of create your own business model or your own mental model, which is different from what you see splashed around in media everywhere and what you hear every second person in the startup ecosystem speaking about? So how do you dare to think and do differently?
So as I said, most of it is market-led innovation. You actually have to define and first understand and then define your levers, right? What is going to drive your business? And try to maximize that lever or the outcome for that lever through innovation or through technology, as you would call it, right? We figured out that this market actually is driven by trust and benefits. So how do you generate trust, right? Once we were experimenting initially, we figured out that the same face showing up, the same every time, where you need to allow them entry into your house, where there might be people of the vulnerable set, you know, ages or gender there, and you should be comfortable allowing that person inside. He comes and actually opens up all the items and tells you, do you find this is the right quality? Do you think the, you know, this tomato should be red or should be like, you know, half ripe, right? Taking care of personal preferences, that interaction actually helps a lot in building the trust and confidence. So then we thought about, okay, how do you manage it with technology, right? You have to reduce the delivery distance. You have to make sure that the same customer and the same delivery rep are actually, you know, even though there might be multiple delivery reps, but a customer to a delivery rep association has to be maintained by the system, and it has to be acceptable for the people or whoever's taken this business, which is the partners, right? So for us, for example, when a delivery rep or say a franchisee or a customer development officer goes around and invites customers, we create a blackout zone for that customer within 0.5 kilometer radius. So that even if there is any other delivery rep or any other franchisee within 0.5 kilometer radius, they can only see this particular franchisee there and have to go with him till the time they keep giving him a good rating. Moment he gets a bad rating, it opens up, you know, blackout zone actually vanishes, and you can choose any other, you know, franchisee in that location. So you have to take care of these. These are all logical innovations or logical solutions which are supported by technology. Okay.
Yeah.
Similarly, in each and every aspect, you can see that, right? How do I reduce the delivery distance? Because I know that these cities are sparsely populated, right? What should be the ideal delivery distance? What if, you know, we say it is 0.5 kilometer, but what if a customer is maybe 1 kilometer away and it is not covered by under the primary delivery range of a franchise? So you bring in that flexibility. How do you incentivize people choosing a franchisee very close to them versus a franchisee which is away? So if you order an item from a franchisee more than 0.5 kilometer, that's when we put in a delivery charge. Otherwise, it's a free delivery for you, right? So that is how we kind of keep on optimizing. And with every iteration, we are optimizing and optimizing the entire thing. If you look at the scenario where we actually pick up the items in near real time and send it to the right customers, right? It is like the Mumbai Dabbawalas who do it without any technology. So we do it with technology, reducing the workforce. But it is like a similar kind of a thing where the right item is picked up from the right distributor and wholesaler, and within 2 hours, it reaches the right customer's home through the delivery franchisee in that particular location. Right. And that is an innovation which has helped us completely eliminate not only the store or a physical store, but also a warehouse for an e-commerce company like us.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that's where, if you see a pure B2B e-commerce companies, they make around 7 to 8% top line margin that they play around with. Our margins are actually double of that. We play around with 14% margin. And that's where I say we give discounts from our margins without burning any kind of cash and still do it in a profitable way.
Right.
Okay. So as I said, this is objective oriented or market oriented innovation. Okay.
Right.
And we solve it once we reach there. It's not like we have an idea with a particular technology. We try to find the best market for it. Right. So that's where the focus is on solving the problems in the market.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And I think, design thinking has become a fad over the last 3-4 years. And yeah, if you look at, the kind of things that you've done and the sequence in which you've done it, this is essentially what design thinking also stipulates.
Exactly.
That you put, the customer at the center of your problem and, start building around it rather than saying, okay, I have this technology, I have access to these resources, these funds, and, what do I build with this?
Exactly.
Right. That's unfortunately the mental model that a lot of people are following, and we all know where they ultimately land up, right? So, one of the things you mentioned in the beginning was about your deep experience of having worked in corporates, particularly in the customer loyalty segment. And over the course of your journey that you've narrated in this episode so far, we could clearly connect the dots in terms of your deep corporate experience versus, what you ended up doing, even though the manifestation of your business model is very different from your initial business model of loyalty management. But, the customer experience is still, I would say, the heart and center of the universe of your business model. Right?
So people often ask us, what are we? Are we a logistics company? Are we a marketing company? Are we an e-commerce company? We say that we are a customer experience management company. Be in whatever field, right? And in order to solve the customer experience problem, we have to solve logistics problem, we have to solve distribution problem, procurement problem, right? Multiple other things that we have to do. But at the heart of it is a customer experience. Sorry, I think I interrupted midway.
No, absolutely. This is what I was saying. And I think the corollary, which we've also seen play out in the life experiences and professional experiences of a lot of people, is that the dots somehow connect over a period of time.
Absolutely.
And you don't know, where you will land up ultimately, but the root of where you land up and the root of your, success or excellence ultimately boils down to some dots, which, you've been accumulating or creating or traversing over the course of your lifetime. And we've seen this in so many different conversations. And, I think your example is no different. Although it's, of course, in a very different sort of space as compared to a lot of other guests that we've had. Yeah.
Absolutely.
In this conversation with Siddharth, we've got a lot of value, learning from his experiences and journey. So if you feel that way, do smash the like button and do subscribe to this channel, because we've got other episodes of Unleash with FTM coming up every Friday. And watch the playlist if you want to check out the other episodes. With that, thank you very much. And we'll see you in the next episode.
Thank you so much.